Talking about really basic animal behavior principles. And then after the break, I'm going to be talking about stockmanship and things that more relate strictly to handling livestock, especially cattle, also some horses in it. But right now, I'm going to talk about general animal behavior. Now, we got a little stress going right on in this picture, bunch of stress. I think the man's mainly got his pride hurt, but the horse is having a really bad case of fear stress. Fear is a proper scientific word. You go over the neuroscience literature, you're going to see the fear word. You know, that word is now getting into the veterinary literature and the animal science literature. You know, years ago I was forced to write in referee journal articles that the animal was agitated. No, it's scared. And I just got interviewed by one of the radio stations, and they asked me, what's the most common mistake people make in animal behavior? Mixing up fear and aggression. Most common mistake. The horse kicked because he was scared or because he was being aggressive. Usually with a horse, it's because he's scared. Dogs, it could be either way, but you need to figure out what the motivation is. All right, no fear handling right there. A calm animal is easier to handle. That is true for every single species, cats, dogs, everything. And once an animal gets scared, really, really scared, it takes 20 minutes to calm back down. You ever had a near miss in a car accident? It took you 20 minutes to calm back down. I was in a car one time where a board flew off another vehicle, and I managed to avoid it. And it took me 20 minutes to calm down after that, and I'm not going to describe the swear words that came out about the board and about the other vehicle. Calm animals are easier to handle. And it takes time for animals to calm back down. Now, how can you tell if your animal's calm? Let's just do a little bit with horses and cattle. If you see the whites of their eyes, they're scared. You've got brown eyes, then a lot calmer. Cattle, the first thing they'll do is they'll put their heads up. When they see something that, not something necessarily they're scared of, but something to be aware of, something that might be a danger, put the heads up. That's the first thing that they're going to do. Okay, tail swishing. You're working with horses, when you're in the vet clinic, one of your first signs that trouble might happen is the horse is switching his tail. And that's your warning before he kicks or bites. That's the first thing that they'll do. Then they'll start to defecate because you've scared the you-know-what out of them. And when you got eye whites showing, your animal's really, really scared. The pot's really coming to a boil. And eye white is a scientifically validated measure. Ears pinned back, that's the first little warning. But you see that tail switching, you better pay attention. If you have an animal that completely goes berserk at a vet clinic, like a cat has gone completely crazy, why don't you just put it in the cage for an hour and let it calm back down? Or the horse throws a big fit. Put him in the stall for an hour, let him calm back down. And people will say, well, I don't have time to do that. But you have time to go to the hospital. You have time to have expensive equipment wrecked and all kinds of other stuff going on. Mr. Bison puts his tail up. He is not happy. Okay, there's a dog right there showing the whites of their eyes. Patricia McConnell has a very nice book on emotions in dogs. And you can get that book online. And dog postures showing things like fear, aggression, it's happy. strongly recommend that book. And I talk about animal emotions in my books. People often ask, do animals have emotions? Yes, they do. Watch what the ears are doing. You see how the horse and the zebra have an ear on each other? And then the other ear is on me. What are they pointing the ears at? Be observant of, you know, changes in their posture. Be a good observer of animal behavior. Now, there's Mr. Bison not happy right there. And don't use no songs, because the next time you want to get them into the chute, they're not going to go. They do not forget bad experiences. Their memories are forever. Now, this chart right here shows you why, from a physiological standpoint, animals getting scared during handling is really bad. I do a lot of talks to laboratory animal groups. And why is it important to have good handling? Well, if you handle the pigs aggressively, shocking them with electric prods, hitting them, screaming at them, your lactate levels are 5 times higher than they would be when you handle them quietly. Your glucose levels are off the chart, you know, by almost twice as high. You totally change that physiology. That's going to mess up a whole lot of experiments you're doing in physiology. No, you want to be handling animals in a low-stress manner. Do they have emotions? All right, let's just look at some of the facts. Prozac works in dogs. If their nervous system was from another planet somewhere, Prozac wouldn't be working in dogs. They have the same subcortical brain systems that we have got. The neurotransmitters are the same. Okay, there's a lot of concern right now about painful procedures. Yes, and they definitely feel pain. There's no question about that. An animal actually will self-medicate for pain. Now, these are the Jack Panskep emotional systems. And these systems are really useful when you're kind of trying to figure out what animals are doing. And they are separate brain systems. Down the base of the brain, you've got nodes that operate these different emotions. You have the amygdala, the fear center. What does fear do in the wild? It enables an animal to survive. That's what it does in the wild. Then you have rage. Predators eating you up, you got to fight them off. Then you have separation distress or panic. Separation distress and fear are two separate systems. You leave the dog home alone, he's chewed up the house. Yep, that's separation distress. And then you have seeking. If you put a lawn chair out in the middle of a pasture, cattle will come up to it. Then you've got the Labrador that wants to chase and chase and chase the ball. That's a high seek. Then you've got a dog you've bred for a service dog. It's a low seek. It could care less about the ball. Imagine each one of these traits on this slide is a slot on a music mixing board. So you can adjust the volume. High or low on fear. High or low on rage. High or low on separation distress. Some dogs handle being home alone better than other dogs. One lab's a high seeker, the other one could care less about the ball. Then you have sex, you've got mother young caring, that's the oxytocin system, and you've got play. Each one of these is separate volume control on a music mixing board. These are non-Mendelian traits. It isn't simple genetics like black coat is dominant. Now, this is some fascinating research. It really shows that dogs have emotions. You need to look up some of these papers. And there's a really, really fun book by Gregory Burns. And he describes training dogs to lay still in the MRI machine. It's a lot of work. But when you do this, you find out that the reward centers light right up when they smell their favorite person. Also, they had to deal with all the hospital bureaucracy. So at first, they were sneaking dogs in there in the middle of the night. They don't have to do that now. But what it shows very, very clearly is dogs have emotions. There's no question about that. Now, you can have different types of, like, nasty experiences. You can have fear stress, separation distress. You can have pain. And you can have physical stresses, hot and cold. And there's some evidence in people that sadness in people is related to the pain system. You'll say, my sorrow was really painful. There's a reason why people say that. the pain system gets involved in it. Now, this experiment shows very clearly they will self-medicate for pain. So you artificially create an arthritic joint, and you provide the animals, either rats or chickens. The rat gets a water bottle full of fentanyl, tastes really bitter, another water bottle full of plain water. And when the leg's all inflamed, he'll drink the fentanyl water. And as he heals, he'll drink the other water. Chicken, it's two different bowls of feed. So it's showing they'll eat something that doesn't taste very nice in order to relieve that pain. Self-medication experiment. So mammals and birds, there's no question about it. Fish, probably have fear. Oysters and scallops, I probably just don't have to worry about scallop welfare. You just don't have enough nervous system there to worry about. Now, what do dogs really need? One of my students, Krista Coppola, did some research and went to an animal shelter. And the controls just got put in a cage the way they normally would be put in a cage. The experimentals got to have funsies with Krista for about 45 minutes. And then the next day, their cortisol levels were down. The ones that had the interaction, the good interaction with the person, the next day, the cortisol levels were lower, salivary cortisols. But the problem is, didn't keep doing it. So the cortisol levels went up. So what do dogs need in an animal shelter? They need someone to take them out every day for 45 minutes and give them a really good time. That's what they need. That's going to cure a lot of the barking. Now, a colleague of mine, Camille King, she is a dog behaviorist in Colorado, and she came to me with an idea for an experiment, and I really suggested that she do this experiment. She said, in my dog behavior business, I'm finding lots of young dogs turning prematurely gray. So I go, yeah, that's just like the presidents. They've all turned gray. And so I helped her develop a little gray scale for measuring gray on dog noses, like none, front, half, and full. And she looked at dogs ages 1 to 4. Then the owner of the dog filled out a questionnaire on impulsivity and on anxious behaviors and problems with the home alone behaviors. And the dogs that scored high on anxiety and impulsivity were more likely to turn gray prematurely by age 4, female dogs being worse. Paper is an open access online. Dog blogs got really interested in this. And I think another kind of dog that may turn prematurely gray is a rescue that's been abused. Abused dogs. They would have high anxiety. Okay, do thunder shirts work? Camille did another little study on that. And she did all the work. I helped her with some of the methods. And so she took her dogs and left them in a kennel, big kennel, empty kennel, a lot of cages in it. When one dog gets to wear a thunder shirt, and the controls wore one that was real loose. So they controlled for clothing, and the pressure was the variable. Put a heart rate monitor on them. And in the dogs that were not on medication, it only worked in the unmedicated dogs, the ones that had the thunder shirt put on tight, the way it's supposed to be, a little lower heart rate, and it reduced the behavior of always facing the door, waiting for Camille to come back. So the thunder shirt did help on that. Okay, what's the difference between wolves and dogs? And I was surfing around on the internet and I found this study. And what it shows is that a wolf is more thinking, more cognitive. And we've bred the dog to be more social emotional. One of the reasons why dogs are easy to train is because they want to please us. So in this experiment, the wolves watch another wolf open up a puzzle box that's got food in it. So the wolf carefully watches, gets the box open. The domestic dog is so busy asking us for help, he doesn't watch enough to get the box open. That's the main difference between dogs and wolves. Dogs look to people to help them solve a difficult problem. Also, dogs pick up a lot of little subtle cues from people that the wolves don't. We have just bred this very, very social animal. Now, I'll sometimes talk about this when I talk about autism, because a little bit of autism, the brain's more thinking. Think of all the geeks out in Silicon Valley. A lot more thinking. See, your brain can be more thinking, or brain can be more social-emotional. You see, and a lot of it's just normal variation. You know, when does geeks and nerds become autism? You see, if you got rid of all the autism genetics, we wouldn't even have any electronic stuff here, because who do you think made it? And I read the biography of Thomas Edison. I'm pretty sure he was on the spectrum. He was labeled a hyperactive high school dropout. And Einstein didn't have any language until he was 3 years old. All right, let's look at some of the data. The thing that's interesting about the research that shows that animals actually have emotions, some of this stuff is old, but it's been hidden over in the neuroscience literature. One of the problems we've got in science is people staying in their silos. Social media is actually making silos worse. But all the emotion stuff was in the neuroscience literature. It's now starting to get over into veterinary and animal science literature. You stimulate the fear center, you get behavioral signs of fear. You also get all the stress hormones, cortisol and things like that, rising up. And look at how old some of those studies are. 1961, I was in high school in 1961. And if you destroy the fear center, monkeys will explore the room. The normal response, if I put a monkey in this room, would be to jump up this curtain and somehow manage to be swinging off the speakers up there. Go to the highest place. But if the fear center's been destroyed, it's going to be exploring everything in the room. Rats no longer fear cats. Yep, they're not going to live very long if they don't fear cats. Now, the main thing I want to get across in this slide is when you force an animal to do something, you get a lot more fear stress than when the animal voluntarily cooperates. So up there on the top of the graph, you've got rough handling of cattle. You've got a deer they netted. I've had wildlife biologists say to me, oh, we held it down for only 30 seconds. It can't be very stressed. Well, what if you went out in the parking garage and somebody knocked you over and took your purse? You'd be real stressed over that. And the cattle, then down there at the bottom of that chart, you got trained antelope. They voluntarily cooperated with veterinary procedures. This is why it's so important to acclimate animals to handling. Really, really, really important. Here's antelope that we trained. Voluntarily cooperate, go in a box, stand still, get the blood tested, get injections. Now, this is an extremely flighty animal. So we had to go through a whole great big long habituation phase. It took 10 days to train them not to be afraid of a sliding door opening. So the first day, I opened the door about this much and he orients. That's all we did that day. Next day, opened about 2 inches, orients. Now when the animal orients, and you've all seen a deer do that, when that animal orients, the brain's making a decision. Do I go into fear mode or do I keep watching? There's a switch in the brain. And we learn never to push them past that orienting. Then once you got them habituated, then you can start doing operant conditioning. But to train the flighty animal, you have to bring each little new thing very incrementally, slowly. Here's some advantages to acclimating animals to handling. Pigs were easier to move when they had given practice runs out in the alley of the barn. If you take young heifers, move them through the chutes, they're going to be more willing to go through the chutes in the future. I want to give you some tips on this acclimation. It's one training session per day. Because if you run them through there multiple times and one after another, they're going to start getting more and more scared. One training session per day. Now, after they walk through the chutes, they need to get some tasty treats. And people say, well, I don't have time to do this. Now, this research is starting to show that this stockmanship really pays. Okay, the 7th and 9th trip on the truck is less stressful than the first one, because now you know what's going to happen. Animals that fear people are going to be less productive animals. This has been known for a long time. There's a scientist named Paul Hemsworth. One of his early papers was in 1981. That's when I started graduate school. And Dr. Hemsworth found that if sows were afraid of people and would jump away from people, they had 6% less piglets. Fearful dairy cows, lower conception rates, higher somatic cell counts. Animals that approach people have lower somatic cell counts. Stockmanship matters. But what I have found, so many situations, is people want the thing, the magic new facility, the new drug, the new computer, some magical thing. They want that more than they want the management. And the older I've gotten, the more I'm going to emphasize the management. You need to have both the equipment and the management. Now, animal memories are extremely specific because they're sensory-based, they're not word-based. Well, Cook found in 2009 that if you acclimate cattle to being fed people on a vehicle, throwing the hay and other things out to them, that doesn't transfer to putting them in the corrals. But think about it. The corrals look totally different than throwing feed out to them. And another research by Leonard and Fent from Europe, they found if you habituate a horse to tolerate a blue and white umbrella suddenly opening, that doesn't train it for an orange tarp. I want you to think about it. Tarps and umbrellas, they look totally different. And with our trained antelope, there were some things we learned about them. The doctor who had previously shot them with the dart gun could not work with them. It didn't matter how we dressed him up. It didn't matter if we made sure he didn't talk. Those animals were afraid of that doctor. And to give you another example of how specific the thinking is, a trained antelope would tolerate people behind the exhibit, people in front of the exhibit. But when the contractors came and got on the roof, these animals freaked out and hit the fence. People up on the roof, that was a new scary picture. See, when you think in words, you tend to overgeneralize. When you think in pictures or sounds, then it's much more specific. Now, there's a lot of things that photographers use that look like umbrellas. Yeah, the horse would probably be all right with an umbrella that's used in photography. But it's sensory-based. I want you thinking about what's your animal feeling, smelling, hearing, seeing. Now, fear memories tend to be associated with things they see or things that they hear. There was an elephant one time at a zoo terrified of diesel-powered equipment. If it ran with a diesel, it was bad. And if it ran with a gas engine, it was good. Well, because somebody probably pushed it around with a diesel-powered construction equipment. And the animal happened to kind of tune in to the diesel sound as being something bad. So when you're trying to troubleshoot behavior problems, I find people overgeneralize. They'll say stuff like, my dog is crazy. My horse went berserk. What did it do? In one case with a horse, the only time the horse went berserk is when you put it in the cross ties because he had an accident in cross ties. Well, I can get rid of cross ties. That's an easy one. But there's a lot of dogs people are getting now as rescues. You don't know what the handling history is. You don't know what thing he's afraid of. Sometimes if you can find that out, that can be really helpful. You need to ask a lot of questions. Now, I get asked all the time how autism's helped me with animals. I'm an extreme visual thinker. When I think about different animal behavior cases, they are specific. It's not a top-down abstraction. Everything I think about is a picture. Make sure an animal's first experience with something new, like you, the table at the vet clinic, or a horse trailer, is a good first experience. Now, one of the ways we can make that first experience at the vet clinic good is give that puppy a non-slip floor at the vet clinic. Okay, and then you go, oh, I don't want to bother cleaning a mat. Well, have the owner buy a mat from some store with a rubber backing on it, get the puppy all used to that mat. It's a nice thing. You bring it to the vet clinic, put it on the table, put the puppy on it, client takes it back home, and you don't have to clean it. But give that animal a non-slip floor. That's a really easy thing to do. But first experiences, if they're bad, can make a really big, bad, permanent impression on animals. You get a fear memory, and it's going to be difficult to get rid of. And the more high-strung the genetics is, the more harder it will be to get rid of the fear memory. Now, this horse is terrified of black cowboy hats because during a veterinary procedure, somebody chucked alcohol in his eyes. And the person who did it had on a black cowboy hat. White cowboy hats had no effect. Now, when I put that hat down on the ground, then it was less scary. And then as I took the hat and I raised it up closer and closer and closer to my head, I could feel the horse tense up, and he was getting more and more afraid of the hat. Now, I had a big black purse that was about this big around. I'm going to bet you if I put that black purse on my head, it would have had the same effect. You know, it would have looked enough the same. Okay, let's just see how good you are at observation. How many people noticed that the horse's ear there was looking at the photographer? That was me. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff I want you to notice. Or maybe an animal will tune in on something like beards. Like beards are bad, for example. Or maybe ladies with giant long hair are bad. They tend to pick out some real obvious feature, a certain type of jacket. Maybe white coats are bad. Maybe white coats are associated with something good. Now the thing is, when an animal gets scared, he often can be quieted down. The familiar person is there. I know that some people today went to police dog demonstration. And, okay, let's say one of those police dogs comes into the clinic. Should that officer be there? It's going to depend upon how that dog is trained. Because you don't want to get into a situation where the police dog is protecting the officer against you. But maybe if the dog has been trained that when he has a certain toy in his mouth, then strange people can touch you. Then he's going to be fine. It's how that animal perceives it. Because in some situations, when maybe a police dog or maybe some drug dealer's dog, that master has to be 5 miles down the road. Not in the waiting room. Small vet clinic, the dog's going to know he hasn't left. Dog hasn't heard the car leave yet. You know, maybe in some real big place, that won't be true. But you want to avoid the situation of the dog protecting the owner against you. Animals make categories in their head. Like, on the leash I protect, off the leash I can go play. I know a big black dog, and when she's outside her master's semi-truck, she's all friendly and nice. But boy, you don't want to touch Millie if she's in that cab. Because she knows when she's in that cab, she protects. See, that's making visual sensory-based categories. A common thing I've seen with cattle, if you're working on cattle with horses, I went to a great feed yard today, cattle land, a really nice feed yard, and I'm doing some really good things there. I was really impressed. Let's say the cattle only get handled by people on horse. Then when they see the first person on foot, they're freaking out and running away. But I want you to think about it. Person on a horse looks totally different than person walking around on the ground. It's important for the cattle to learn how to go in and out of pens with a person on the ground. Horses can get a similar thing. Maybe the horse is really hard to handle for groundwork, like for veterinary work. But he's fine with somebody riding him, because somebody riding him never did anything to him. I knew a horse that was afraid of naked white saddle blankets. If you put a saddle on top, it was fine. But if it was a naked white blanket, then it was bad. That's how specific sensory-based memory is. Rapid motion, it makes dogs chase, and it makes horses and cattle run away. Sort of different species, different effect of rapid motion. Now, this is a camera that they used at the HBO movie, and it moves really slow like this. And you can take it and you can put it around the heads of cattle and they don't react to it at all. Sudden jerky motion is going to scare them. So there's a lot of things that they pick up on. Okay, if I was galloping a horse down this road, probably going to end up on my head because you're going to see this lid in the middle of the road. That's the kind of stuff that you need to be watching out for. Hopefully you'd pick it up before you went riding, but if you didn't, you better slow down before you get to it. Little distractions in the environment, animals will notice. Things you tend to not notice. There's a chain hanging down in a chute. Why do I still have to talk about this? Because people are not taking them out. That's why I have to keep talking about this. Little things that people tend to not notice. Non-slip flooring. All right, let's see how good you are at observation. How many people noticed that that animal is looking at the sunbeam? Raise your hand. Good, we're doing super good here. That's good. I did this at, I showed this slide to physicists at Fermilab and no hands went up. And I show it to fifth graders and third graders, 75 or 80% of the hands go up. Guess kids are more of a visual thinker. Okay, look at that picture there. See anything wrong with that picture? Yeah, it's in a brace position. Yeah, go on and look online at how many dogs are in a brace position on the table. That's not exactly going to make them real happy. Here are some behavior principles of restraining animals, ranging from cats, dogs, horses. Sudden, jerky motion scares. Steady motion, like that camera. Moving like this, that doesn't scare. And don't be sneaking up on them and then like stalking them. That is scary. Also, you have to hold an animal, either with your hands or like with a hydraulic squeeze chute. There's an optimal pressure, not too tight and not too loose. The mistake it's made is when it struggles, they squash it. And do not trigger the fear of falling. I've already talked about the non-slip floor, but you also need to make sure you're holding it in such a way that it's not going to get the fear of falling. And if it's an animal with a big flight zone, might be a good idea to, you know, cover its eyes. But you need to cover its eyes with something it can't see through. T-shirts don't work. It needs to be like quite a few layers of dark towel. Now here's some examples of extreme fear behavior. A horse comes to a show and he's gone berserk. Flags, bikes, and balloons. I call them the big three. Those are the things that can really, really scare an animal at a, at a horse show or maybe a cattle show. What's the best way to get your animal used to something like flags? Decorate the pasture with flags and let your animal walk up to it. See, something new is attractive if the animal can voluntarily approach. New things are scary when you shove it in their face. And the animal that has the flighty genetics, maybe an Arab horse, for example, is the animal that's going to have the biggest startle response. Let the animal voluntarily approach new things. Let's look at horses bucking when you change gates. Well, the reason why that happens is a saddle feels differently at different gates. So if you see the horse start to switch its tail when you change gates, then let's stop that lesson right then and there before he bucks. So he switched the tail, he warned you. You better pay attention to that warning. Or maybe the cat is seeing her first dog at the vet clinic. You know, we're getting more and more indoor animals that lead a very sheltered life. Get exposed to something new, they're really getting upset about it. Something new can be a strong stressor, but it's attractive if they can voluntarily come up to it. Yeah, put a clipboard down to pen a cattle. They're going to come up to it. And then the wind flips the paper and they run away. And then they come back again. And they'll alternate. There's a video you can find on YouTube, I think it's still there, of a toy car being going around, remote control toy car. And they put it out in the pasture and the cattle run from it. Then the weirdest thing happens. The cattle start to chase it. Then they have another scene where there's a circle of cattle around a toy car. And they're just looking at it. It makes a little move like that, and they jump back. It's both scary and attractive. And scientists have found a switch. There's a switch in the brain where you can switch back and forth between something that's scary and something that's attractive. Now, when you get a big fright, like what I got when the wood came off this other vehicle. Yeah, that took a while to calm down. But just a little bit scary, it can kind of switch back and forth. And a paper flipping or a little car moving about like that's not that scary, and explains this curiously afraid behavior. Now, how much this system can also be biased more towards fear or biased more towards seek. There are genetic components in that. And then you got your abused animals, it's going to be biased more towards fear. Okay, I get asked all the time about slaughter. Are animals afraid of getting slaughtered? I had to answer that early in my career. And these are two slides back when I first started. Producer's Feed Yard in Maricopa, Arizona, and the Swift plant in Arizona. So I'd go back and forth between the two places, and I found that the animals behaved the same way in both places. Now you'll notice right here, well, this isn't a very good pointer, that fence isn't very high. Those cattle were totally capable of jumping out, but they didn't. Now one of the things in this plant they were scared of, you see how dark the entrance looks? Yeah, they don't want to go in that dark entrance. And if you look at the stress levels, cortisol levels, slaughterhouses and feed yards and ranches, they're about the same. They range from high to low, but it's about the same. And a lot of the stress of a slaughter plant is novelty. And Borquette over in France found that animals that have a big physiological response to something novel at the farm are the animals that have the biggest physiological response at the slaughterhouse. Now this is, I was down on the movie set, and there's a trained Holderbrook heifer. Now you'll see those cattle off in the background. Those cattle were behind me where I took this picture. There were probably 100 vehicles for the movie crew. Those cattle actually came up to the water to look at the vehicles. But there was one problem. They had not trained this trained heifer for reflector boards. They're like white styrofoam panels or aluminum-covered styrofoam panels that are used for the lighting. And they suddenly moved a reflector board. And we were just going to take a PR picture. And the heifer started rear up to go on top of me. I screamed, "Don't move it." Then he moved it again, and I was not saying niceties after that. Okay, this is what reflector boards look like. And they can move around really jerky. And they had assumed, since they had all these white box trucks on the site, that the animal would not be afraid of reflector boards. But box trucks don't move in an erratic way. Box trucks tell you they're coming. It's a very different sensory experience than reflector boards getting flipped all around. Yeah, they are not equivalent things. What's scary for one animal is just normal life for another animal. These bulls are living amongst all these whirligig things. But when I opened the door of the car, they ran off. That was something new. So you got to start looking at how is your animal perceiving it. I had a chance to go out and visit a pig farm. They were selling into one of the niche markets, straw-bedded pigs, cornstalk-bedded pigs. And so as a visitor, I had to put on plastic booties. Well, they didn't get that many visitors. So plastic booties were a big novelty. Animals coming up to the plastic booty because it is something novel. That's the thing. Novelty is both scary and attractive. Go down to the Philippines. Oh, bikes don't scare them there. Those cattle live along that highway right away, and they have seen everything. But bikes can be bad because they're silent and they come up fast. Better get them used to flags before they go to a show. Now, there's an interesting interaction here between temperament. That's basically startle response. How easily does that animal get scared and doing something that's not very nice to it? Like training an animal, the halter breaking an animal by just tying it up to a tree. That is not the way to halter break an animal. Now, if you do that to a Holstein, you'll pull back and get over it. You do that to an animal with a more flighty temperament, it doesn't habituate. I think it gets kind of like a post-traumatic stress syndrome. It stays scared. And there's a heifer that somebody ruined by trying to halter break it in a real rough manner and ended up at the slaughter plant. Little foals, You know, I'm not a fan of any kind of rough handling of foals. If you just pet the mare, and don't pat the mare, don't do this. Stroke it. Make it feel like the mother's tongue. Now, don't do tickle touches. Don't pat it. Stroke it. So you stroke the mare, and then you just reach over and stroke the baby. You'll have hands all over it. But don't be sneaking up on it, and don't do tickle touches. One of my students, and this is a long time ago now, about 20 years ago, did some of the very first research on cattle temperament. And animals that went kind of crazy or got extremely agitated and shook up the squeeze chute, tried to jump out of it, they had lower weight gain. 20 years ago, that was radical stuff. Now that's known. But we got to be careful not to over-select for temperament, because you don't want to lose other traits, maybe mothering, maybe foraging. You over-select for any one trait, you're going to mess up your animal. Another one of my students, Connie Flurka, did a study, and she showed that there was individual differences in how mama cows react when their calf's threatened. When you threaten with a strange vehicle kind of circling around like this, some animals will call the baby, others don't. So a better approach to temperament selection is to get rid of some of the really crazy cattle. But don't turn beef cattle into a bunch of Holsteins. Now, this is a really interesting research done by Belyev. The Russians wanted to develop a really nice, tame fur fox that wouldn't bite your hand off. Now, see how lanky and lean he is, the shape of him? 20 years of selection for gentleness. You end up with a border collie fox dog. Look at the difference in the shape. Lanky and snarly, thin body, heavy set. But if you overdo this, then you get epilepsy. And I'm concerned that some service dogs right now that are being selected for calmness, I've heard some complaints. I talked to a blind lady just recently, and she told me that she had to retire two service dogs for, you know, guide dog, because they got epilepsy at about age 4 or 5. Yeah, and you can't use that for a guide dog. You over-select for any single trait, you are going to wreck your animal. Whether it's a production trait, it's an appearance trait, doesn't matter what the trait is. Lameness right now in dairy cattle is really, really high. That's an example of bad becoming normal. I'm a big fan of measuring animal welfare. So on the dairy, I know there's some people here really interested in dairy, I'm going to measure how many cows I've got that are lame. How many have a swollen hock? How many have thin body condition? How many are dirty? Those are outcome variables. And when you start measuring it, then you start managing it. And there's been 3 studies that have shown, if you go to a dairy where no measurement's been done, and you ask them what percentage of your cows are lame, they'll underestimate it by about half. And I've got my textbook here, Improving Animal Welfare, Practical Approach. And if somebody's really interested in going into farm animal welfare, you know, as part of your practice, that'd be a good book to get. It's expensive. I did not set the price for the book. The little extra profit they're getting here is going into your association. I do not get any of the money. Also, you select just for production traits, you might lose disease resistance. There is always a trade-off. Always a trade-off. When the pig industry, back in the 80s, went into selecting just for leanness and rapid growth. They got problems with aggressive pigs that tail bit and excitability. Now there's a white layer that looks very nice when she's young, but when she gets old, she looks like a rag. Yep, now this particular line of white layers, they've phased out, but this was purely genetic. Put everything into the eggs, not much left of the hen. Look at the difference here. Between a layer and then the white bird is the meat bird, the broiler. They almost look like different species. Here's a pig with very bad leg conformation. I'm getting concerned right now that some cattle, beef cattle, are getting leg conformation issues. We need to be making sure that the animals that we breed have got good leg conformation. In the late 80s and early 90s, when they were just selecting for production traits, they didn't realize how messed up the legs were until half the market pigs were lame. That's not a good thing. Here's just a little chart right here for leg conformation. It's one of the things that we need to be looking at. This is corkscrew foot in cattle. It's a genetic defect. He looks really pretty, but if he was a human being, he'd have Tourette's syndrome, because about every 30 seconds he flinched. Yeah, let's not be breeding problems. What happened to those pig's ears? Another pig ate them. This is from some of the genetics back from the late 80s and early 90s. Now, nobody would deliberately breed an aggressive, nervous, excitable pig. And why did this problem get so bad? The problem is that the breeders of these pigs did not see other people's pigs. This is an example of bad becoming normal. The reason why I was one of the first people to notice it is I'd go to the meat plant and there'd be pigs in the yard there from 10 different producers. So I'd go in and shake the gate on one bunch of pigs, they wouldn't even get up. I'd shake the gate on these pigs and they start squealing and going crazy. Huge, huge differences in their temperament. But that was only obvious when I was seeing different pigs from different producers right beside each other, where I could compare them. Well, that's going a bit overboard on muscling. And there's a German pig. He was brought up to the plant in a BMW. They like BMWs and Mercedes. He's bringing pigs to market. Super big hams. And there's the Chinese pig. She's all reproduction. Lots of tiny little piglets and not very much meat. There are genetic trade-offs. I thought this was a fascinating paper from Science. These are Scottish wild sheep. If the animal has a really strong immune response, it's more likely to only have one lamb. If she has a lower immune response, more likely to have twins. See, that's sort of the trade-off between the economy and the military. Military being the immune system. Okay, there's another weird pig right there. Now we're going to end up on the bulldog. That is what they used to look like. And then he got this deformed freakazoid. Yeah, that's a full on that's going to keep the veterinarian in business, you know, to take care of all his folds. And I think we're getting into some bad becoming normal on this. Does this dog have good welfare? You got to work really hard to make sure it has good welfare. But let's look at what they used to look like. You can go online in the Google for images and type in bulldog's dilemma and get this picture. 1938 bulldog. You got some legs, you got some snout. How'd you get to this? It happened slowly. Maybe we need to put this picture up on the wall of the breeders, because that's what it was originally. You know, I have problems with this. Can't walk, can't breathe in a can of its babies normally. Okay, I gotta show off my books here, but there's one thing in behavior I want to show here. You see how the dog on animals in translation has this nice, relaxed, open mouth. And then the other dog on animals make us human, he's not, I wouldn't say he's scared, but he's clamped it shut, which means he's vigilant. There's something he's a little bit concerning. See, that's the kind of stuff I want you to pick up. And then that's Improving Animal Welfare, Practical Approach, and also the genetics book. Now, I want to get into the part I like doing the best before we get to the cookie break, is questions. I'm going to pick somebody. Nobody has any questions because we want to have lots and lots of time for discussion. Okay, who am I going to pick? Okay, how about this red shirt up here? I like bright colors. Somebody's certainly going to have a question, because I'm going to pick somebody until we get the conversation going and we get the ice broke here, okay? What would we do with wildlife? When you capture wildlife, it's really, really stressful. And we need to be working on some ways to make that less stressful. And I would think, like, you know, beta blockers, drugs like propranolol have a lot of anti-stress. The military is using that right now for PTSD. And the thing about beta blockers, they're not a controlled substance. You don't have to worry about the people abusing it and getting addicted to it and everything else bad. I experiment with drugs that are not controlled substances to reduce some of their stress. You know, right now they're blasting them up with antipsychotic drugs, which is kind of questionable. But to find something you could give that animal to make it a whole lot stress, to cut that fear stress. And for a long time, I think people don't want to recognize that that's really stressful to them. Also, there's individual differences. I was talking to a guy one time where they had some bighorn sheep that had been bred, and they had them in some big pens, and they had to grab them and catch them to get blood samples. And he said to me that some of those sheep, the heart pounded so fast they thought the sheep was going to die. Another sheep did not get as high a heart rate. See, there's individual differences in how scared it gets, basically. You know, and there's a lot of variation within a population. But this stuff's, you know, really, really super stressful. Sometimes people don't want to admit that something they're doing with the animals is really, really stressing it out. Oh, they'll go back to the pen. The easiest thing to do, let's say you're in a barn that's got plastic floors, but the alley is concrete. The easiest thing to do is just open the gates back against the fence. They won't mix. And you just let them explore that new floor. I remember one time we had them on raised plastic decks. And if you put them down on the concrete floor, these were wieners about this long, they were immobile. They wouldn't move. So the next bunch, I took them off the deck, so I lifted them off and put them on the floor. And then I took a break for 45 minutes. I come back and they behaved like little angels and went and moved easily because they had a chance to explore that floor. You know, the best thing you can do is give the animal a chance to voluntarily explore something. You see, the more voluntary the motion is, it's also extremely important with pigs that the producer walk the pens. And what you want those pigs to do as you walk through them is to just quietly get up and just move away. Animals differentiate between a man in the alley and a man in the pens. You can have feed yard cattle that are raised indoors that are tame to the person in the alley. But if you've never gone in the pens till the day of loading, you're going to have some real problems. They're very specific. It's really important that they get used to people walking through them. Real, real important. And I don't want to teach them just to chew up boots, just walking through them and they just quietly get up and move away. Then when it's time to load those pigs on a truck, they're going to be easier to load. And the other big thing is moving small groups. If you've got a narrow alley on a pig farm that's about this wide, it's 3 to 5 you bring out at a time. Small groups of animals. Okay. Yep.
So you, and I'm not sure if this is sort of where you want to go, but if you have, a lot of people have multi-dog households nowadays. Is there any way to manage those properly, or like aggression or fear between animals?
I mean, these are animals. Well, with dogs and cattle, one thing that's really bad is an animal reared alone, where it doesn't learn at a young age how to interact. And once it has become dominant, it hasn't learned, well, let's back off. It doesn't have to keep fighting. Dogs reared alone, horses reared alone, cattle reared alone, they do not get along with others well at all. And they get into fights that are worse. It's really important. Puppies get socialized to other dogs, that adolescent dogs get socialized to other older, well-socialized dogs. Also, we have got to socialize puppies to toddlers. Or you can get into a very dangerous prey drive situation. They need to learn at a young age, and don't let the kids maul them, that toddlers and little kids are people too. I think a lot of animals today, we're getting more behavior problems now than we ever had because they're not experiencing enough stuff. When I was a child, we lived in the suburbs, and all the dogs ran loose. Now, we did have dogs killed by cars. That was the downside. But the upside is, we had no behavior problems. All day in the daytime, the dogs are out socializing, playing with the kids, and they'd come home at night, and about the only behavior problems they had was puppies chewing things, and that was about it. But on any behavior thing, what I find is people tend to overgeneralize. They'll say, my dog is crazy. Well, is he crazy, cute little thing, impulsive, wants to jump on you because he's happy? Or something big and snarly going to come after you? Maybe both of those could be a crazy dog. Now, snarly, I'm now seeing a dog that was whining and barking in the hotel room next to mine. And I suggested to the hotel manager that maybe we could bring him to the office. And we opened the door to this room, and he was really bad. And we slammed that door, and we're not bringing him to the office. Okay, so when I say big and snarly, I see that dog. And he was in a real flimsy wire cage, and we got that door shut real quick. And he whined and barked every time somebody walked down the hall. I did not get any sleep that night. And the people that owned him were away at a concert. It was miserable. But there was no way that we were going to touch him. He wasn't whining when we opened that door. He was snarly. You see, but I see that specific picture. I can even tell you where the hotel is. It's Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And when the plane got diverted due to the weather at Harrisburg, I had to stay in that hotel. Okay?
How do you differentiate between animals that are playing or fearful? Like, I know with puppies and kittens and stuff, people like to chase them, but like, how would you tell if a cat or dog is like actually scared and running away or if they're actually playing?
Well, on a dog, are you getting that play bow behavior? You know, where they crunch down like this with the butt up in the air. And if you're getting the play bow behavior, another thing you got to remember, hugging across the shoulders is, you know, like when a dog will put another paw up here, that's dominance in dogs. In people, it's like lovey-dovey. And dogs will learn to tolerate that, but if you go and you look on Google for images, you're going to find all these pictures of dogs with their mouth clamped shut when kids are hugging them across the shoulders. Funny thing with cats sometimes is that you stroke them and they're loving all this petting, and then all of a sudden they scratch. I think sometimes that's hard to predict. But the dog, you look for the play bow. But then I've seen people play rough with dogs, and they think the dog is, they're playing really rough with the dog, especially a smaller dog, and the dog's starting growling, and I'm going, hey man, this dog doesn't like what you're doing, stop it. Well, I also found out that this particular dog, I'd go over to this person's house, this dog liked me better than she liked him. So that's another thing that tells me that this dog did not like being roughed up that bad. Now, the Patricia McConnell book on animals' emotions, really good book. It's got lots of great photos that show all the, and they're photos rather than drawings showing the different emotions. But that play bow, that's the easy one if they're doing that. I just watched a silly movie on the plane yesterday, Frankenweenie. Yeah, he did a play bow in the movie. So somebody knows something about dog behavior when they made that movie.
I find lots of times it's cats that have like the hardest times in small animal clinics. Besides like the whole like, I know you're supposed to like be like putting your fingers in their mouths and touching their feet and stuff as kids.
Well, and get them used to that. Yeah, you see, the thing is, these things are getting animals acclimated. See, it's just like the cattle. All of these things, someone has to take the time to work on desensitizing the cat to being touched so that when he goes to the vet, it's not such a traumatic experience.
Is there anything else, like, out of the sort of, like, normal things that you hear that you could tell owners to do that would help
well,
them?
Stroke it, give it a non-slip floor to stand on, and you pick it up. The thing is, make Kitty's first trip to the vet clinic a good first experience. Now, there's going to be some situations where she's had such a bad time at this one particular vet, you might have to go somewhere else. Now, is she going to be okay somewhere else? It depends upon what the fear memory's on. Did it tune into the white coat? Did it tune into the table? Did it tune into the smell? Sometimes you don't know. See, and if you can figure out what they're afraid of. I was talking to some people who worked in a research lab, and they found that the dogs were fine about getting their shots as long as they didn't see syringes. You know, that there was that somehow seeing it, maybe it was just being held harshly. See, the getting scared is often a lot worse than the shot is.
And you have to kind of pretty much take that on an individual.
Well, hopefully what you want to try to do is like you bring the puppy in, feed it some treats, make those first experiences, good first experiences. And the thing is, that's going to take some time. And people that are working on low stress stockmanship will talk about take the time to get to know your animals, work with them. These things take time. And too often, people just want to do stuff too quickly. And then you're going to have a cat that's going to be problems. Then it might be better with that one to give it, you give them a prescription to give it before it comes in. You might have to.
Do you have any advice of getting fear aggressive dogs out of kennels that won't come out on their own?
They're just an aggressive dog won't come out of a kennel on its own. Well, you know, see, it might be scared. So you don't know. So you don't want to end up getting bitten. That's the thing. If you have the time, one thing you could do is it has to come out to eat. Want to eat? You're going to have to come out. See, and then I would always have water in there for it. But you want to eat, got to come out. The other thing with a lot of rescues is you don't know the handling history. You know, what was done to this dog before before you have something to do with it. You know, why is it acting the way it's acting? First thing you got to say to yourself, is he truly aggressive or is he just scared? Now, you can get bitten just as badly with fear as you can aggression. But it's important to know which one it is to kind of know how to deal with it. Okay.
I was kind of wondering about, you talked about separation anxiety.
Yeah, that's a separate emotional system from fear.
Yeah. So is that, what's sort of the evolutionary background for that? And would you see it in non-social animals like, say, a cat?
Well, less likely to see it. Cats tolerate home alone a whole lot better than dogs do. See, we've bred dogs to be just so tuned in to us. And there's different, you know, strengths. Imagine separation distress, or I don't like Panskep's word panic because that gets mixed up with fear. You know, you got a slot on the music mixing board for adjusting the volume, and some dogs have that volume really turned up high and they don't handle home alone well. Now you can train it maybe to tolerate increasingly long periods of time away. But there's some dogs where they get so upset about being home alone, maybe you need to share the dog with a next door neighbor that doesn't go away during the day. You know, some doggy daycares are good, some are terrible, but some dogs just don't handle that well at all. I've heard some real horror stories of teeth busted on a chain link fence. I mean, just really, really bad things. And this was separation distress. And there's another lazy old dog that's fine. See, this is where the genetics interacts with what we do with it.
I guess on that same note, when you can identify a specific thing that I'm afraid of, for instance, the whole cat being afraid of it, or I was once sitting a dog that was a rescue, and paper towel, like if you lifted a paper towel.
Lifted a paper towel roll?
Yeah.
Well, maybe somebody had gone after it with a rolled up newspaper. And that would be enough similar to paper towel roll. You see, there's a little bit of visual generalization. Okay, I'll give you an example. I knew a dog that was terrified of hot air balloons. And I think the reason for that was a hot air balloon flew over and revved up its burner and scared her. And then she started getting afraid of weird stuff. Like was in the car behind a gasoline tanker going up a hill and she throws a great big fit. She was freaking out at street lights. So then we started making a list of the things that she freaked out about. Okay, bad things. Street lights, gas tanker rear ends, and hot air balloons. Okay, other things that maybe had some similarities of being round. Round globe light against a brick wall, no problem. Stop light, no problem. We put them on a list. Then I start to visualize that the common denominator was round against the sky. So when you think about it, a gas tanker going over the top of a hill is a round thing against the sky. A street light, especially those cobra head ones, round thing against the sky. A stoplight has that black metal triangle behind it. the pizza parlor had globe lights against a brown wall. So it was round against the sky. You see how that's kind of a visual generalization? That was the bad things. But in order to figure that out, well, I had to talk for half an hour. I had to write down, okay, here's bad things. Here's stuff that I tried to, then I tried to think about something that might be kind of similar to streetlights and gas tankers. But then I just visualized, okay, you know, how it would go up over the hill. You've got a round thing against the sky. And she was terrified of that. Because we found out that she was terrified of hot air balloons, even really far away. You see, I'm visualizing, sorting stuff she's afraid of versus stuff she's not afraid of.
Is there any way, once you identify what they're afraid of,
to... You can work on desensitizing.
Okay.
But the first thing you've got to do is identify the thing they're afraid of. You've got to know that before you can start desensitizing it. And then you work on them, you can work on desensitizing it. And then the more high-strung the animal is, like the startle response, gets scared easily, harder it is going to be to desensitize it. See, the other problem you've got is the fear memory can never be erased. It can be suppressed, but not deleted. And so it can sometimes have a flashback. And there's also genetic differences both in veterans and in dogs. Some animals, when they're getting a very, very, very nasty situation, it stresses the nervous system out more.
Okay.
Same thing with people, too. Some people are more prone to PTSD than other people. You've got things like short and long serotonin transporter chain. So environment interacts with genetics. But the first thing you got to do is you got to figure out what's setting it off. And in a rescue, that can sometimes be hard. Now, a common one is men are bad. I hate to say it, guys. And then I know a dog that didn't like baseball hats. You know, where some other kind of hat would be okay. Or maybe it doesn't like a certain type of shoe. Because when it was beat up, guess what it's looking at? A shoe. Okay, let's do one or two more, and then we can have a break.
How do you feel about dairy cattle and their calves being separated right away?
Well, the dairy cattle, separating the calves right away, they've been doing that for... I worked on a dairy when I was 14 years old, and they separated cows from dairy calves. And that's something that's getting to be more and more of an issue. But I tell people that's not something new that the dairy industry started doing. I mean, my first exposure to dairy was like 1961, something like that, and they were separating calves. But there's going to be more and more things that consumers are going to question. And I think there's some things that have to be changed, especially in pig housing and in layer hen housing.
Do you think it's like a welfare issue for how long that they stay with their mothers versus taking them right away?
That's something maybe somebody needs to, you know, look at that, whether it's better to take it right away or let it drink. It's good for the calf to get some colostrum. That's something you're going to want it to get. Okay, there was a question right back there.
You had mentioned before about how we are over-selecting for a lot of traits and how we're leading to increased lameness at the level of the dairy industry. How do you go about convincing an industry, especially at the producer level, that we need to value the animal welfare and the results of over-selecting?
Well, actually, one thing that's happening in dairy cattle now and in chickens is it used to be just select for production. Now they're kind of backing off and selecting for some other traits. They're getting a little more holistic in how they're selecting for traits now, which I think is a good thing. You know, the other thing about a high-producing dairy cow, and Nigel Cook in Wisconsin has some papers on this, is when they have top-notch management, they're doing fine. But a little bit of something starts to go wrong, like maybe you don't provide enough feeder holes. So the subordinate gets shoved away from the feed, then that high-producing cow really gets in trouble. This brings up another important issue in animal welfare. The research is very clear. Yeah, you want top production. You give each dairy cow her own nice, soft, comfy place to lay down and plenty of feeder space. And then the Economist comes along, the same journal, and tells you to skimp on the stalls and overstock it. Because even though the cow's production goes down, you come out ahead on the barn. Well, I think we need to be, you know, there's a point where you just can't skimp anymore. Yeah, there's a lot of things that are economic that, yeah, maybe you still shouldn't be doing them. You know, as far as welfare goes, let's just talk about measuring welfare. The first thing you got to do, and I talk about this in this book, let's say you're in charge of a dairy farm, or you're in charge of supply chain management for a major grocery chain. And my job is to make sure that in my supply chain or my dairy farm or beef feed yard, whatever it is, that I don't have something really bad happen. First thing I got to do, step one, is to make sure we don't have acts of abuse going on that would look really, really bad on the internet. The next thing you're going to do is let's start measuring outcome indicators. In a dairy, I'm going to measure body condition score. There's a 5-point scale, they're easily available. Measure how many lame cows I've got, dirty cows, and cows with swollen hocks. I can measure that stuff. And then I can tell, am I getting better, am I getting worse? Okay, in beef cattle, out at the cattle land feed yard, I was really pleased to see the scoring system for scoring handling. And you score, well, how many animals did you use electric prod on? How many vocalized when you caught them in the squeeze chute? Because if they vocalize when you catch them in the squeeze chute, you're hurting them. How many animals went racing out, fell down? These are things that I can measure. You see, and this helps prevent bad from becoming normal. So the second step, I'm going to use numbers to make sure that I don't have a bunch of neglected health problems, too many sick animals. These are things I can measure. Then the third step is behavior needs. And this is especially becomes an issue in pigs and in laying hens. You know, some of the research in laying hens, for example, has shown that the hen has a really strong, hardwired, instinctual behavior to lay her egg in a secluded nest box. So that's something we need to provide for the hen. Then animal welfare specialists are now talking about, well, does that animal really have a life worth living? Dave Fraser at the University of British Columbia will talk about natural elements like sunlight, things like that. Science can tell me the first three, but it's purely an ethical concern on things like natural elements. Does it really need sunlight? Does it have a life worth living? You can look up the work of David Malor. But when I'm working in the practical world, I want to make sure we've got to deal with the bad stuff first and make sure bad stuff's not going on and get in measurements on handling, feed yards. I'm going to look at dirty cattle. In the southern parts of North America, heat stress has to be monitored. That's not so much of an issue here. Open mouth breathing. You've got open mouth breathing in cattle at rest. You've got a bad heat stress problem. I like real simple things, easy to measure. I can measure lame animals. I can tell you how many have got a swollen leg, or they are dirty, or they're breathing with their mouth open. Very simple, straightforward things. I don't like vague guidelines that say things like, handle them properly. I don't know what that means. Adequate space. I don't know what that means. I want real, clear outcome variables that are like traffic rules for livestock. Stop signs mean stop. Speed limits, you measure that. Drunken driving, you can measure the breath. You know, real, real clear things. Texting, yes, we can pull your phone logs if you have an accident, and we can find out whether or not you were texting. You know, these are things that are not subjective. Also, you need to look at, well, I like the food safety system of critical control points. You can't measure everything. Okay, let's say I'm doing a food safety inspection. I can't measure 100 different things at a food factory. You got to figure out what are the really important things to measure. Well, sterilizer temperatures and cooler temperatures, that's real important. In beef, how you skin out back legs is really important. You have to figure out what is really important and not just have masses of paperwork. And too many things are just turning into masses of paperwork. You know, everybody's very good at faking that. I don't know if that gave you any insight or not, but we've got to deal with, we've had situations where somebody's doing some grass-fed cattle and the poor things aren't getting enough to eat. Yeah, that's not okay. You still got to score for body condition. Well, you can't let them get too skinny. Okay, I think right now we'll take a little break, and then we'll be back in just a few minutes. And I want to thank everybody for coming, and I'm going to be talking more about cattle, maybe some slaughter stuff afterwards. All right, get down and look through your chutes and see what they're seeing. You see how the animals there can see a red car through the fence. Vehicles parked along facilities can often be very distracting. You got a little red piece of string there that might be moving. We already discussed a chain hanging down in a chute. Now, this is what I call the dark movie theater problem. It's a real sunny day outside, and it's dark in this cattle handling facility, and they don't want to go in there. Now, if you open up some windows so they can see through the building, that's going to help. And today at the cattle land feed yard, they had some white translucent panels in the building. Now, at night, I can light this building up with electric lights, and it'll go right in. But the problem that I have on a sunny day is I can't get enough electric lights to compete with the sun. So they don't like the dark movie theater. It's the way you don't like the dark movie theater. Now, here are some white translucent panels that have been put in the sidewalls. This can oftentimes help a lot getting cattle into buildings. Now, here you've got an animal balking at a puddle. And you see how that animal's just looking at that puddle? Well, she's getting about ready to cross. But if her head was down, she's not going to cross. If you push an animal, when it stops at something, heads down, it's not going to cross. They're not going to cross when they've got their head up. Ron Gill at Texas A&M says you've got to get the head neutral, and then they'll move. Give the leader a chance to look at something that you can't get rid of, like this puddle. There's a backstop gate at the entrance to the single file. If you put a remote control rope on that, hold it open for the cattle, they're going to go in easier. In fact, I'm really getting to kind of dislike backstops. You might want to put a sliding gate there. But don't make all those animals go clumping through that backstop. Now, one of the things that's good here in this picture is it's high enough. So if you've got tall Holsteins, they're not going to bump their backs. The most important things of working cattle on ranches and in feed yards, move small groups up into the crowd pen area. I cannot emphasize that enough. Good handling is going to require more walking. That's another thing we talked about at the cattle land feed yard today was people go, oh, I don't want to walk so much, so maybe I'll bring 8 head up. And then it gradually goes on to 15 head. No, small groups, really important. Fill the crowd pen that leads up to your single file, fill it half full. And the one gate that always needs to be solid is the crowd gate you shut behind your animals. Now you can see right here the flight zone, almost sort of like a bubble in the shape of, you know, like a, it's almost like the people have a force field around them. Now the size of that flight zone can be really variable. Animals that seldom see people have a bigger flight zone. Animals that have been badly treated will have a bigger flight zone. Tame animals that are trained to lead have no flight zone. They can be difficult to drive. So what you see there where you've got the clear area, that's the flight zone. But you've all gone out in the pasture and seen the cattle turn and face you. Now that's a zone, kind of a zone of awareness just outside the flight zone. Okay, right here, when I walked up to these black cattle, they turned away. I entered the flight zone. Now you see the tan animal? He's turning and looking. I'm in his zone of awareness, or maybe a pressure zone would be another name for it. And then you've got the cattle far away, they don't even know I'm there. All the other things that can enlarge that flight zone is if you do a lot of rapid movement. That will tend to make the flight zone bigger. Here's a really handy-dandy way to get animals into the squeeze chute without having to use electric prodders on them. So let's just pretend that this is the squeeze chute. I got them lined up here. Well, maybe this might be a better squeeze. This is your squeeze chute. So here's the tailgate right here. They're lined up here. So I step forward and quickly walk back by them. This diagram is on my website on Grandin.com. It's in the Improving Animal Welfare Practical Approach book. I've got a book on humane livestock handling that's got this diagram. It's also on this computer if somebody wants to get it off this computer. But this is kind of counterintuitive. You're walking back past the animal in the opposite direction of desired movement, and then they go forward. It really does work. Try it out. The other thing you got to not do is stand at the head of the animal and poke its butt. know, you got to be behind the shoulder to get it to go forward. Okay, this particular facility's got a solid outer fence, but if you're working in a facility where one of the fences is open, you have to stay away from it except when it's time to go in there and move the animals. Because if you stand next to it, he's going to rear up. What this man should be doing, he needs to back up. Back up and get away from that animal. And you see how the ear of that animal is on the person? He needs to just back up, get away from it. Then it will go back down. How long should I make my single file shoot? I don't want to get it too long. You can get them too long. At 200 feet long, that's bad. But on the other hand, you don't want to have a chute that's maybe only one or two cattle long. You want to be able to put four or five, at least four or five in there, so I can get some following behavior. So I can use their natural following behavior. Okay, some squeeze chutes have got rubber louvers on the side so they don't see you standing there. But manual squeeze chutes, you've got to stand up there right close to the squeeze chute. And if you put a piece of cardboard on the back half of that squeeze chute, the cattle may be more willing to come in because they don't see you standing there right close to it. Some hydraulic squeeze chutes have controls that are mounted further away, which is really a nice thing. But this is just a very simple thing that you could try. Now, there's been a lot of discussion in the industry. Do I put solid sides on a chute or do I put open sides on it? Now, I've been around for a long time. And I've been advocating for a long time solid sides. But the thing you got to remember is, when I first started, cattle were wild. The industry in North America has done 20 years of temperament selection. A lot of the cattle we have now, especially the European continental cattle, just aren't as wild as they used to be. But if you have an open side on a chute, sort of imagine that the animals have a force field that comes out of that side. You got to stay away from it. And if you don't stay away from it, you're going to start getting a lot of antsy behavior. It's going to require more skill to operate it. And if you have solid sides, might be better off less skilled people or really wild cattle. Now, the most important part to cover up is the outer perimeter. So when people park all the vehicles around it, they don't see all the vehicles. This shows some of my layouts. Now, there's a basic principle in cattle behavior. Cattle want to go back to where they come from. So you want to lay a tub out in the full half circle. You can have a lot of discussions about different types of facilities, but layout mistakes can really, really wreck you. Here's a super important slide. This shows right and wrong. And if you lay it out, dead end of your chute, bending it too sharply, that animal, when he looks up there, can't see a place to go. That's not going to work. Another mistake is getting crowd pens way too big. That can be bad. Now, this is a little simple design where it's solid on the outer radius. Again, these are on my website. They're also in my Humane Livestock Handling book. But instead of working around the outer perimeter, and I don't have a pointer here that works. Let's see if pointer on the, yeah, this works. The handler stands right here, and then you shut the gate, and the cattle come right around and go up the chute. You work the pivot of the crowd gate. Another thing that you can do is, let's say you're out on a ranch and everything's working terrible. You can't get them out of the crowd pen. Try working the other side of the pen. That sometimes will work. Another basic principle is use your crowd pen as a passing through pen. Wait until you got space in that single file. Then you bring the cattle into the crowd pen and then go right on in. Because if you fill the crowd pen, when the chute's full, guess what? They're all going to turn around on you. They want to go back to where they come from. Here's another one. Take advantage of that natural circling behavior. Solid on the outside and seep through on the inner radius. But you've got a big area here, like all around here, where you've got to stay out of there except when it's time to move the cattle. Because if you just stand here, they're going to be jumping around. Don't want to be doing that. And a lot of people have probably heard about the bud box layout. Very, very simple, but it's more skill dependent. It's kind of two philosophies of design. I can make something more expensive that requires less skill to operate, or make something extremely simple but it's going to require a more skilled operator. And the way this works is, and Joe Stuckey's talked about this, you put the cattle in here, then you stand here, they circle back around you and go up the chute. Now there's a basic principle, what you put in here, it has to fit in here. And there's way too many cattle in there. I think this is a drawing of Guffman Joe Stuckey. It's actually off scale. Those would be calves. Those are calves, small calves. The artist did not do this right. I've got some other bud box drawings. They're not as pretty as this, but the cattle are drawn to scale. But the thing is, what you put in here has to fit in here. You cannot store cattle in here because they come in and circle back around you. Cheap to build, but more skill dependent. Okay, what about driving aids? Well, some people suggest we don't need any driving aid at all. People get way too rough with way too much waving and flapping. The first thing that handlers have got to do is they got to calm down and stop yelling at cattle. You've got to calm down. An electric prod should never be a primary driving aid. The only place you might need an electric prod is to get a very stubborn animal into the squeeze chute. Buzz it once, and then put it away. Get it out of your hand. This just shows some other layouts that I have done. So here are your design concepts. I can make something very simple, but it requires more stockmanship skill, or make something a little bit more expensive, but it's much easier for unskilled people to use. Okay, these behavioral principles, restraint, already discussed. Okay, we already discussed that slide. All right, here's a slide I really like. My student went out and measured cattle handling at 28 big feed yards in Nebraska, Kansas, and Colorado. I'm very happy about these scores. The average electric prod use was about 5.5%. The worst feed yard was 45%. Back in the bad old days, early 90s, 80s, and 70s, it would have been 105%. It would have been way more. Vocalization. If animals moo when you catch them in a squeeze chute, catch their head or squeeze their body, they moo in direct response to that, you are hurting them. With maybe too much pressure, they should not moo in direct response to the device. Vocalization score about 1 or 2%, that's really good. Falling under 1%, really good. Stumbling, that's going down on the knees. Miscaught, that's things like catching around the head, catching around the middle, and running. Maybe we still need to do a bit better on running. But but when you measure handling, what this does is it prevents bad practices from slowly creeping back up bad. Our beef quality assurance is measuring. I was very happy to see that Cattleland had the measurement system posted on the wall. You manage the things that you measure. This is the original temperament data. Basically, what we found here is that animals that went really crazy in the chute had lower weight gains. Don't overselect for temperament. We already talked about this calf study. That chart we discussed when we talked about that right there. Well, you want to get some animals attracted to come in, put some very expensive photographic equipment out in the pasture. I guarantee you they will come up to it. We've already discussed very specific animal memories about the man on the horse and some very dangerous things that I have seen with feedlot cattle at a packing plant is where they meet their first person on foot at a packing plant. Real super dangerous. You put them in a pen, they rebound out up over the top of you because they're trying to get you out of their flight zone. Or you take calves that have never been handled on foot, take them to auction market, bouncing off the walls because they've never been handled on foot. Before animals leave a ranch or leave a feed yard, they need to know how to go in and out of pens with a person on foot before they leave. Get rid of dogs around chutes. All they do is teach cattle to kick. Acclimate animals to different vehicles. Some of the worst animals for getting really scared and berserk behavior is an animal that has a high-strung genetics that almost leads to shelter life. Maybe one old truck, one person. They aren't used to different vehicles, never been acclimated to different people. You manage the things that you measure. I want to prevent bad from becoming normal. This is going to apply to handling. It's going to apply to lameness in dairy cattle. It's going to apply to, you know, many, many different things. Okay, there's your handling scoring. Percentage of animals that run. Percentage of animals that fall during handling. Percentage that stumble. Percentage that moo when you catch them. You do this score before you do an ear tag or an implant or some other procedure. Percentage with a move with an electric prod. Real simple yes-no scoring. Did he moo when you caught him or put him in the chute? Yes or no? Did he fall coming out? Very, very simple. There's also some differences in how different cattle handle. Some animals are much harder to handle than other animals. Then I can determine, do I have a problem with one producer that's just got really, really difficult to handle animals if I score them. Now this is some of the work I did with the meatpacking plants. And when I collected baseline data back in 1996 for the USDA, only 30% of the plants could shoot 95% on the first shot because equipment was busted. That's management. And when McDonald's started measuring, yeah, they had to fix the broken equipment. And then we did the other handling scores, vocalization, prods, and falling. It's amazing that when you start measuring things, things got better. And the thing that amazed me is we took a number of shabby old facilities and we made them work. Non-slip flooring and lighting. These are indoor facilities. So I could change some lighting and make a reflection go away. Get rid of air blowing on them. And we very quickly got the plants way better. Only three plants out of 75, this is in the U.S. originally, had to buy fancy equipment. Everything else we fixed with simple things. It's the same principle as food safety. Hazard analysis, critical control points. We measured five simple things. If I was going to measure, if I was only going to enforce five traffic rules, I'm going to enforce speeding, stopping, you know, red light and stop sign violations, drunk driving, texting, and seat belts. And if I just enforce those five things, I'm going to get 95% of the public safety. That's what a critical control point is. It's also directly observable things. I'll tell you one thing, it's a critical control point on phones. They better not catch on fire. That is a lot more important than broken screens are. A lot more important. You're talking about burning up people's cars, burning up their houses, burning up airplanes. It's also not a paperwork audit. I'm very concerned that too many things today are turning in one big gigantic paperwork audit. Okay, there's kind of different types of variables. The trend now is to go with what's called an animal-based outcome measure. Okay, we already discussed that handling scoring. Those are outcome measures. I'm not telling you what kind of cattle handling facility you got to have. I'm just telling you what it's got to achieve and what the people have to achieve. Dairy cows, skinny sows out on the pig farm, those are animal-based measures. Then you have to have some practices that you just don't allow. I was on the original OIE slaughter committee, and I wrote things like do not drag them, drop them, or throw them, poking sensitive areas, cutting tendons on beef cattle. Nobody would do that here, but in some parts of the world they were doing that. You got to just come out and say, this is really bad stuff we're just not going to do. And 100 countries can sign off on it. And getting away from tons of input-based standards. Well, now there's still a few that you need. Some space requirements on vehicles, some maybe feeder and water space. There's still a few of these you need. But I don't want to get into the minutiae of designing a free stall. Because I can evaluate a free stall on a dairy or a cubicle, whatever you want to call it, based on the outcome measures. Is the cow clean? She's not lame. And her hocks, are, you know, she's got good hocks. Does not have swollen hocks. If there's something wrong with that stall, the dairy will probably fail on at least one of those measures. That's what I mean by an animal-based measure. Lameness is a really good example of a critical control point. Look at all the different things here that might make a cow lame. That's up for you guys to fix. Lots of different things here. Okay, if I'm doing a welfare audit for a grocery store, I'm not going to go look at foot diseases, but I'm going to watch them coming out of the parlor, and if you've got a lot of lame cows, you're going to have to do something about it. Leg conformation, we already talked about that. beef better start watching out for this one. Okay, and we're getting a lot of new genomic power tools now for selecting sires. Power tools are wonderful things, but they got to get used with care, because that circular saw can take your hand off quicker than the handsaw does. So you want to make sure that as we select for things like production traits, we don't get other problems, like leg conformation issues. I showed you that pig, showed you that. And then obviously, we're not going to do things like poke sensitive areas or drag downers. Now, since I've been involved with a lot of supply chain management with many different corporations, some here, also some in the States. Okay, you write in the guideline, don't beat animals. So then you throw somebody off the approved supplier list for beating animals. And they say, no, we didn't beat those pigs, we just tapped them. Well, I've got a video online called Proper Use of Livestock Driving Tools. And when an empty box starts breaking, that's beating. I've also got videos on how meat plants work, beef plant video tour, pork plant video tour. You might want to take a look at those. But what you need in regulations is using the traffic rules concept. What are the relatively few things we really need to enforce? Not getting into just all kinds of minutiae. Here are some input measures we may still need. Maybe some water and feed space requirements. There's a few of these you may still need. But they need to be simple. You can't say, provide adequate ventilation on a truck. I don't know what that means. Do proper handling. I don't know what it means. You've got to have something clear, because if I'm running a supply chain and I got to take somebody off the list, I got to have something that's totally clear. That's my website, Grandin.com. I got lots of information on that. Feel free to copy it. The diagrams that I show are on there. And maybe while we're doing questions, I want to just put this little diagram for walking back by them up here to look at. You can write it down. This little diagram, yeah, that right there. Okay. They wanted me to get through this relatively quickly, so I'd have lots of time for questions. Okay, right there.
What's your perspective on breeding for polled cattle strains?
About polled versus?
Yeah, polled versus horned cattle strains.
Whether the polled strains and the horned strains are as good, this is something we're going to have to be careful about. Now, if you go in and you snip out the horn code with CRISPR, that's gene editing. Okay, you have GMOs where you insert new DNA from something else. Then you have gene editing. Go in there, snip out the little piece of code that grows a horn. That strain should be the same. But now you played with the DNA code. Hopefully people will accept that. We're going to have to look carefully at things. Traits are linked. On the plane, I was reading about how genes fold, and how there's lengths of code that are like in a neighborhood. And then that length of code goes in a bow like this, and it's tied with a special little piece of chemistry. And those kind of stay together. And there may be linked traits in there. You know, there's things we still don't know. We've got to watch carefully. I'd like to get rid of the horns, and especially in dairy cattle, getting good lines. If we snip it out with CRISPR, we probably don't have to worry about messing it up. But will the public accept that? I think part of the problem we have with the GMO mess is that flew under the radar and the public didn't know about it for 10 years. People don't like surprises. That doesn't work very well. And while thinking about GMOs, I want to give you something to think about. Go online and type in teosinte, ancestor of corn. And you will see a plant that looks like wheat with corn kernels. Does today's corn made with natural breeding look anything like the ancestor? No, it doesn't. Nobody's made something that extreme with the GMO. I like to get that up on my phone and show that to people when we talk about GMOs. Say, well, you know, that was done with natural breeding. And there's been plenty of trouble we've gotten into with natural breeding. And what happens is, take the bulldog, for example, it's slowly changed. That's bad becoming normal. How did dairy get up to having 30% lame cows? It happens slowly and you don't see it. Okay?
What improvements do you think can be made in the swine industry? Like flooring changes or enrichment, something like that?
Well, in the swine industry? Well, you're already going to work on phasing out gestation stalls. I went to a very good seminar last year at the Banff Pork Seminar here in Canada. And it was a veterinarian from the U.S., I think he was from Nebraska. And he was talking about his experiences with group housing. And initially, they were real negative towards it. And they were switching to the electronic sow feeders. And he learned some things. Don't put too many sows on a single feeder. Don't push these systems. The other thing he learned was they had to find the right person to be their hog whisperer. Somebody that was patient and laid back, that would take the time to train the young gilts and not scare them in the process. And they used an electronic scale to train them. That takes stockmanship. And this brings up another issue. Stockmanship, like good pen riders at a feed yard, this needs to get a lot more respect. Okay, when low-stress stockmanship workshops, there are a lot of them out there, they talk about taking the time to get to know your cattle. That takes time. Stockmanship needs to be given a whole lot more credit. It's really important, and it's just as important as the piece of equipment is. You need to have both. When I first started my career, I thought I could build anything, magic equipment. I can fix half the problems with that. The other half is the management, and top managers need to recognize the importance of things like stockmanship, and that's one of the things that this seminar talked about. Okay? It depends how you use the dogs. I hate them around the chutes. And one of the reasons why I hate them around the chutes is I've been nearly killed twice at a meatpacking plant with cattle that double-barreled kicks to the head, and they're in the single-file chute. Dogs used correctly out in the field, I've seen some very, very good handling. Really done right with dogs. But around the chutes, I hate them. And they're snapping at the cattle's legs under the bottom of the chute, just hate them. So used right in the right place, they can be really, really good. So I'm not going to universally condemn dogs. But things that teach cattle to kick, that's, I get kind of sensitive about that. And the other thing that's real dangerous at the plant are the cattle that are meeting their first person on foot at a plant. Super dangerous. Put them in a pen, fly right back out and in your face, because they're trying to get you out of their flight zone.
When it comes to a lot of research with animal behavior in agriculture, it seems like no matter how much great research we do, consumers still have different notions in their mind of what's best for the animal.
Well, this gets into the other, and the other thing is consumers don't necessarily do with their pocketbook at the meat counter what they say they're going to do. The other problem is, okay, let's look at the thing with the McDonald's chicken, for example. I'm on that committee, and I wrote in that book, Animals Make Us Human, I thought the colony cage was, science was showing that was the way to go, an enriched colony cage that gives the hen four things: full height walking, so she can walk normally, and then a private nest box, a perch, and a little place to scratch. That's what the research showed. McDonald's paid a lot of money to look at colony cages and an aviary system and battery cages. And the aviary system had like horrible death loss, dirty air, dirty eggs, and then the new CEO decided to go cage-free. But leave it to ingenuity to make a cage-free that's going to work. Take colony cages, and you put the chickens in the colony cages. 3 days later, you take the doors off. And they made a little takeoff and landing pad in the front of each one so they don't crash land. I didn't see a single bird crash land in that, and I was in it for 2 hours. It's still a really intensive system, but that they're free now to choose what deck they want to live on, and they have a scratch area underneath. Herbrooks is going to, you might want to read an article in Fortune magazine called Free Bird. What the consumer is concerned about, Gail Golab at AVMA puts it in our vet association, puts it really nice. I maybe shouldn't imitate how she says it, but she's so cute how she says it. She goes, they don't like it when you put them in little boxes. They don't like it when you cut bits and pieces off without pain relief, and they want you to kill them nicely. Now, when you really look at welfare, things like lameness, that should be at the top of the chart. Somehow people don't seem to get so concerned about chronic lameness, which causes pain. Yeah, and that's probably a bigger welfare issue than some of the other stuff. But that's how people perceive it. And we've got to come up with ways to fix it. And I had nothing to do with that decision. Joy Mensch, their poultry specialist, had nothing to do with it. We were called the day before the decision was made. Heads up, press release is coming out. But the ingenuity, you see, the thing that Herbert's came up with, I think it's going to work. They've already got the death loss way down. The atmosphere has greatly improved. The eggs have been cleaned up a lot. And they're still working on it.
What do we do about that?
Do about what?
How can we reach out to the public? Is there any other ways we can maybe get to the consumer?
I think that what ag's got to do is open up the door. And ag has not always been very good at that. One of the reasons why I did the beef plant video tour is I wanted to show stuff. You know, there's some stuff we got to show them what we do. And Fair Oaks Farm. You know who's doing super good on this? Look up Fair Oaks Farm and Pig Adventure. Fair Oaks is also going to have a new cage-free egg layer operation that they're going to open up to the public. They're doing all kinds of stuff with integrating livestock and crops together. All kinds of really great stuff, and they are open to the public. Ag needs to be doing a lot more stuff like that. And then you get into big ag and little ag fight each other. They both have their place in the marketplace. You know, they're both ag.
Thank you.
Okay.
Are you concerned at all with, like, auditory stress with cattle when they enter into, like, a slaughterhouse plant?
Yeah, the one thing I still want to fix in slaughterhouses is the noise. Yeah, that is something that one of the problems you have is materials that absorb noise are not cleanable. Now, I went in one slaughter plant where the entire stunning restraint device was in the yards. That solved the noise problem. The animal shot, and then the carcass was taken into the noisy plant, you know, along a rail system. But noise is still one area that could be improved. Yeah, I think it is stressful. Well, the vocalization scores, what I found on them, restraining devices that squeeze animals too hard will make a high vocalization score. In fact, I'm writing a paper right now on restraint methods for religious slaughter. There's one place that's got a 47% vocalization score, and it's published in the literature, mainly from electric prod use. Another place that's squeezing cattle too hard, 25% vocalization score. I did a paper years ago where they were squeezing a neck too hard, 23%, and when I reduced the pressure, I dropped it to zero. So the main things in a slaughterhouse that will make you get a terrible vocalization score, and that's only scored going into the restrainer and in it. It's not scored bulls fussing out in the yards. Excessive pressure from a restraint device, electric prod use, sharp edges, leaving them in it too long. You put an animal in a head holder, you need to shoot it right away or do the religious slaughter right away, like right away, like in 10 seconds, or they're going to start fighting the head restrainer. But when you get good handling, you can get the vocalization scores down, you know, 5%, 3%. The rest of the animals are silent. You all of a sudden get a high vocalization score in a squeeze shoot before the procedure is done. Obviously, if you brand them, they're going to move. You got something wrong with the squeeze shoot. You're squeezing them too hard. You're bashing them on the head with it. You're doing something bad with it. Vocalization score is a real sensitive indicator of stuff going wrong in a restraint device, either in a feed yard, a ranch, or at a plant. Yeah, it's a really good critical control point because it will pinpoint a lot of different problems. And when things go wrong, it skyrockets. Okay?
When doing research and you need a blood sample or whatever, different animals, for me, I'm talking about pigs, but how do you make it less stressful for them when, like, there's no sedation and usually it's a one-time thing happening, but...
Okay, make it less stressful. Where do you want to make it less stressful for the pigs?
Well, like, we do orbital sinus bleeding. And they don't particularly like being
No, and they're not going to like that very much. And the problem is that nose snaring is real stressful. This is something that's, and they don't want to do it again. There are some restraint devices that you can put pigs in that they tolerate a whole lot better than being snared, but then you've got to get the device through the alleyway that's this wide at the farm is part of the problem.
Is there anything that you can do in terms of almost training, like you were talking about, to make them less fearful?
Oh, you could train them. There's all kinds of things you can train animals to. It takes some time to train animals. Okay, the research that showed very clearly in Ronaldo Cook's papers in the Journal of Animal Science show very, very clearly, if you take your young heifers, spend some time walking amongst them, get the flight zones down, let them come in the corrals, tie all the gates open, tie your backstops open, let them walk through the corrals. You know, then you run them through the chutes, but only one training session per day. Don't run them, and then you feed them afterwards. It helps a whole lot, but it takes time to do it. The thing that's difficult is convincing people they need to take time to work with young heifers. It's just like the pig whisperer. For the electronic sow feeders. Somebody has to take the time to do it. And what they found, it was real interesting, and this is not going to be in the paper that's in the proceedings, the guy that was always late, he'd come in and do it at 9 o'clock at night. He was the best. And then they had another guy that probably, they didn't dare drug test this guy, tattoos all over him. And he was the guy that could really was patient enough with the young gilts, teach them how to use the feeders. And he got so proud of what he did. And then when the big bosses came, he got a long sleeve shirt, covered up his tattoos, shaved off all his hippie hair, and because he was really, really proud that he was the pig whisperer and doing a really good job on the stockmanship. And nobody else had the patience to work with the pigs. See, what I have found on training people in stockmanship, there's about 20, if I take 100 people off the street, you have about 20% that will get it. You teach them a few things, they get it. Then you have a whole bunch in the middle you have to constantly supervise. And then you got 10% that maybe shouldn't be there. Maybe they need to drive the feed truck, work in the feed mill, somewhere else. And we found that with the packing plants. Because in the packing plants now, they've put in video cameras. And at least in the US, they are watched by a team of people at Mission Control in Huntsville, Alabama. And if something's going wrong, that plant's immediately emailed that there's a problem that they need to fix, and that solves the problem of acting good when they see somebody with a clipboard. Watching it, and what we found with the plants, there was 10% of the people driving either pigs or cattle that had to go. Also, we found originally when we started this program, there were 3 plant managers that had to go. I call it a plant manager ectomy. And everything got fixed when they got the new plant managers. See, it gets back to attitude of management, but the management's got to recognize that taking the time to train these guilds is what makes electronic feeders work or some other kinds of feeding systems work. And there's great innovation that's going on. Canada's a leader in some of the innovative equipment for group housing of pigs. I'm very impressed some of the things I saw at some of the pig conferences. Okay, right there.
I know there's been a lot of kind of things about animal welfare and transport to slaughter. How do you think that we could improve?
How it improved it with what at slaughter?
Like transportation to slaughter?
Well, just people measuring it. For when animals unload at the plant, they're measured now on electric prod use, falling down. Making sure the truck's maintained. you know, you don't have, you know, a broken slat in the side of a truck where a foot can come out. Maintenance of equipment is really improved. See, when we first started the program, one of the first things we did is we just went through and said, hey, you got to fix broken stuff. And a lot of stuff with non-slip flooring, and it was amazing what we could fix with lighting, put up a sheet of plywood just in one place, and we could make stuff work. With transportation, driving is really important. Don't stomp on the brakes, don't stomp on the gas, because that throws, especially cattle, throws them off balance. Fatigued drivers. The other thing is on the ranch, we need to be pre-vaccinating and pre-weaning our calves 45 to 60 days before they are shipped. And there's still way too many calves put on trucks screaming their heads off, and then you wonder why they get sick at feed yards. And why does that happen? There's no accountability for that loss. When they get sick, they're somebody else's problem. You know, that's not the truck's fault. You know, the first thing you got to do in transportation is put a fit animal on that trailer. And a calf being weaned on the truck's not a fit animal. Jennifer Woods does a lot of work on consulting on transportation. And she did a little internet search of truck accidents and found there was a lot of truck accidents. A right-hand accident where it just goes to the right and rolls over. That's because the trucker fell asleep. You know, it's just like that, and the trailer's usually not too badly messed up. Falling asleep. And it's in the early hours of the morning, like 3 o'clock in the morning, stuff like that. See, a lot of things are management things. And you got to make sure you don't overload them. But there's big differences in bruises between driving, between drivers. The problem we're getting, we feed a lot of Holsteins, and we're getting a lot of back bruises right here. Super tall Holstein steers coming up out of the bottom deck, and they're hitting right here. And there's been some design changes in some of the ramps to give a little bit of more back room coming out. That's something you can do to the truck. But the first thing you got to do is just manage them right. The expert on that here in Canada is Karen Schwarzkopf. You probably need to talk to Karen Schwarzkopf. She's in this province. She works for the Department of Agriculture. Karen Schwarzkopf. Don't tell me I don't know how to spell it. It's really weird. But she's an expert on it. Ed Pager here could put you in contact with her. Okay?
What can veterinarians do to better support people who have dogs with behavioral issues?
Dogs with behavioral issues? Educate people, but let's not be so general. Dogs with behavioral issues. Puppies chewing things is a much less of an issue than something big that's going to bite somebody really seriously. So I'd rather not be getting too generalized about this. I refer them to, if it's something big and dangerous going to bite somebody, you get referred to a really good trainer. Work with the dog. And then you have some dogs. We had a hideous thing that happened to one of our faculty members. Older people, my age, out walking their dog, and there was a pit bull cross rescue on another leash. No hackles, no growl, no warning. Jumped up and grabbed the 60-year-old woman right here and took her down. And if the two men hadn't been there, that could have been very serious. That's like, ugh. No, I don't think that dog is never gonna be safe. And the problem is the people that adopted that dog didn't know anything about the handling history. That was 2 years ago. Someone in our department that happened to.
In the swine industry, how can we convince producers to adopt better welfare practices in the face of fluctuating hog prices?
You know what made things change? In my career, this was mostly in the U.S. where I did this. There was the pre-McDonald's era and the post-McDonald's era. And in the pre-McDonald's era, that would have been 70s, 80s, and the 90s, I found that selling equipment to plants was easy. I got a lot of center track restrainers around. But one of the problems I had is half my clients tore up equipment, wrecked it, wouldn't work it right. Then we started the McDonald's audits. using that really simple scoring system. Stunning score. You had to shoot 95% dead on the first shot. Everything dead when you hang it up. You're allowed 3% focalization score, 1% falling, and a 25% prod score. If you couldn't make those numbers, you failed the audit. And they just had to make their numbers. They knew exactly what they had to do. I saw more change, and it's all in the, our JAVMA journal, Journal of the American Veterinary Medical Association, and Applied Animal Behavior Science. I got six papers on it. Whole thing is documented. And we held them to those numbers. The first thing you had to do is fix broken stun guns. There was some have to now. Big plant would lose $1 million worth of business a year if they didn't do this. Fix busted equipment. That's the first thing they had to do. The other thing that made it work is I bent over backwards to do reverse conflict of interest. I didn't shove any equipment down their throats. Whatever they had there, and we made some shabby old junky places work. Maintenance, repairs, training, supervision, lighting, and non-slip flooring, and some stuff with airflow, we did. And we were able to fix all of the plants except three of them out of 75. And it worked, and it was absolutely objective. It was the customer making them do it. But another reason it worked is we didn't have a stupid guideline in there that said, stun them properly. No, you had to make 95% of them unconscious on the first shot. Now the plants have gotten so good, they're running about 99%. And they do a lot of maintenance. It was a customer that made a change. And when the customer, the other interesting thing is when I took executives from McDonald's, Wendy's, and Burger King on their first trips to slaughterhouses. When things were going great, they go, oh, this is fine. And when things were bad, like really compromised, disgusting animals coming into the supply chain, I saw true undercover boss moments, just like that show, Undercover Boss. Oh, whoa, there's some stuff here we have really got to fix. When those suits got out of the office, saw exactly what was going on. Boy, it was like a giant tidal wave. It worked. But it also worked because the scoring system was simple and I was not shoving expensive equipment down their throats. Whatever they had there, stun box floors, we redid a lot of stun box floors. But I didn't have any conflict of interest there. No shoving equipment down their throat. The three plants eventually did have to buy some expensive things, but we let them take 3 years to try to do it without the expensive things.
With something like the Ontario beef industry, where we raise calves and ship them out here to get to weight and then ship them back to Ontario to be slaughtered, is that something we should be working towards somehow patching that up so we're not shipping?
Well, there's problems with the long distance shipping. I am more concerned about the management. Were those calves pre-weaned, vaccinated, 45 or more days before they got on that truck? I'm more concerned about that. Was it good driving? Were they stomping on the gas? In the summertime, did they let the truck boil at a truck stop? Did they get a sleet storm and they didn't put any slats on the side of the truck? It's a sleet storm. You see, that's management. Pigs, you got to be really careful about putting your plastic panels in the right amount. You see, that is management. I don't think that's optimal. They have to travel that far. But I'm more concerned about the management side of this. They better not be putting bawling calves on those trucks. You got to look at where's the true critical control point. For phones, they better not catch on fire. Period. That's more important than anything else about a phone.
When it comes to animals that are handled like routinely, how can we tell the difference between like true habituation and like a learned helplessness kind of response?
I mean, if, you know, like when the animals are handled for what?
Like it came up in lecture about bucking broncs and bulls. Like in the chute before they're about to go out. How can you tell if they've actually become habituated and like comfortable enough in the chute versus like just becoming helpless at that point?
Well, if you looked at Ed Page's work on the bucking bulls, and I watched a lot of those bucking bulls. I went to Calgary Stampede and just with a real, I watched the bulls from the best contractor. Open the door, it walks in. That's one sign. You know, you have things really going good in the slaughter plant, they walk in. I've seen animals that have been really hurt in a squeeze chute, and they were just about impossible to get in. I mean, they remembered that thing had bashed them on the head really hard, and they did not want to go in. That's why they call it chute sour. And they don't forget that kind of stuff. But I've also worked in the slaughter plant. I run a stun box, and I open the door, and I just walk in. You know, but the animals that have had terrible chute experiences, you know, they'll tolerate a certain amount of discomfort, but being slammed on the head really tight, really hard, I've seen them enter the chute partway, and they get up the head gate, they're just going like this, and they know exactly which part of that chute hurt them. Then they'll go in the squeezing part, but they won't go in the head gate part because it hurt them. There are some places where you have a system for feed trials where they've got to stick their head in a slot to eat. You can get an animal that kind of got down in one of those things, got stuck in one during training. You never get them in the thing. They just get too afraid of it. Now, now where were they discussing you might have learned helplessness?
He just brought up the point, like, we're at the point now where we just have to, determine whether or not it is, like, they're truly comfortable in that chute or whether they're just...
Well, another thing I've seen with cattle is sometimes they'll perceive that they can avoid it further back in the system, where once they get in the lead-up, they'll go in, but they're turning back in the crowd pen because maybe they perceive that they can get out of doing it then. But I have seen animals absolutely, absolutely refuse to go through a handling facility. Absolutely. And then I know for a fact they had some pretty bad stuff happen. One of them was, way too many students palpating up their backside. You couldn't get them out of the crowd pen. That was learned. I am not going to do this. I'm going to be like defiant. I have seen that. And they just were not going to go. But I've also seen, for every one of those animals that won't go, I've seen hundreds of other animals where they just walk in. Like you do the little walk back by them and they walk in. Okay, right there.
Is there a way for consumers to know that the meat they're getting is coming from places that have higher quality of welfare standards? Like, as a consumer, how do you...
Well, and the slaughter plants overall in North America have gotten so much better. You know, that the slaughter plants are a different industry than what they were in the bad old days. Then you see, they were the easiest part to fix. First of all, if you're running something like the McDonald's supply chain, you're talking about like 45 beef plants. You know, it's easy to send an auditor out to 45 beef plants. Send an auditor out to hundreds and hundreds of ranches. That's much more difficult to do. You'd have to do a random sampling of ranches. Probably go out to the major feed yards. Now, what people I've consulted with a lot of clients, corporate clients, on supply chain management. Like, let's say, for example, you're selling grass-fed beef. Well, if you're selling grass-fed beef, then you can't feed it grain. You know, I tell them, whatever you say in your label, whatever you say you're doing, you got to make sure you're actually doing it. If you want to feed them a little bit of grain, then you need to say they're grass-fed up to this age, and then they have 30 days of grain at the end. Okay, then you said what you're doing. You've got to actually do what you say you are doing. And the other thing that people need to do if they're running a supply chain, like for a retailer, those corporate vice president level people need to get out of the office, find out what's going on in the field, just like Herb Kellerman does with Southwest Airlines. He's retired now. Every month he did a job. He'd be a ticket agent, a baggage handler, or a flight attendant. Every month he did a job on the front line, a real job, work a whole shift. So he actually, he forgets what the reality, so he never forgets what the reality is. See, part of the problems we get with a lot of policymakers is they're too far away from reality. And the only legislation where they really know reality is elevators, traffic, and airplanes. And those have sensible but strict regulations. And nobody's trying to mess with that. Because they use those things. It's not abstract. Okay? What do I think of humane slaughter enforcement? Well, some of the guidelines, I haven't read your guideline word for word lately, but some of our guidelines, it says you got to have 100% perfect stunning score. That's impossible. And then on the handling, you got to minimize excitement and agitation, whatever that means. So that's very subjective. Now, the thing I have found on being on animal welfare committees is a lot of people don't want to put a hard number on it. Traffic has a hard number. There's a speed limit sign there that some traffic engineer decided. And the thing I've found is I've traveled all around the world, and, well, there's some countries where the speed limit sign is a suggestion. But you still have somebody, you know, some kind of, like, recommendations for different speed limits. They put a number on it. Then it's clear. It's not do it. You don't see in a traffic, your traffic book, drive at a prudent speed. Drive at a speed that's safe for the conditions. Now, we have guidelines for livestock that are with that kind of wording. I don't even know what that means. Because I've had to work with clients, commercial clients, that when they got to kick somebody off the approved supplier list, it better be clear because you end up in court otherwise when they sue you. That's, you know, so that's the other reason why you've got to have a clear guideline on what passes and what fails. We have a Nan? I don't know whether I was getting a hint from you or not. Okay. Right here? All right. Okay.
How do you feel about, like, carbon dioxide slaughter?
CO2 for pigs?
Yeah.
Well, on CO2 slaughter, any kind of chamber type thing, you got to look at behavior before loss of posture. When the animal faints and falls over, either loses consciousness right exactly when it falls over, or maybe just a couple of seconds afterwards. So you mainly are looking at behavior before loss of posture. There are genetic differences in pigs. Fortunately, in most of the US and most of Western Canada, they've gotten rid of the lines of pigs that react badly to CO2. Pigs, you got to put them rapidly into high concentrations. Chickens, you have to raise it very, very slowly, the levels of CO2. If you raise it too fast, they're going to have a bad reaction. But you look at that outcome behavior. That's the thing that's really important. You know, that, and there's some really interesting new papers out, Turlo from France, on what's definitely conscious. Then there's a twilight zone or transition zone. They call it a transition zone. And then there's dead brain dead. Corneal reflex is gone. It's brain dead.
Do you find it's done well then?
It can be done. Now, one advantage you've got with the large CO2 machines is you get rid of single filing. Cattle's an animal that out on pasture will walk in single file out on pasture. You've seen a little lanes that cattle make on the pasture. They'll walk in single file. They single file up a chute really well. Pigs, I don't like to do that. So you got a big CO2 machine designed to handle groups. I can completely eliminate electric prodders. That's super good. So I can get a fabulous handling system. And when we score it, you've got to make sure your power gates don't knock pigs over or drag them. Falling's falling, whether it's a power gate or it's a manual gate, it doesn't matter. So I can totally get rid of the prods. So you have to look at your whole system. A captive bull is instantaneous. Electric stunning is instantaneous. But to present the pig, or especially the chicken, for electric stunning, you have to hang the chicken upside down. That's stressful. So let's say on the induction, I got a little bit of discomfort. Maybe that's a fair trade-off for the good handling. You got to look at your whole system. Now, where I draw the line, if I'm evaluating the induction, either poultry or pigs, if that animal attempts to get out of the container, that's an escape action. That is not acceptable. But let's say it just did a little bit of this or something. Well, that's probably better than getting a lot of electric prods stuck all over it. See, again, you got to look at your whole system, your handling and the stunning. People have a hard time doing that. All right, one more quickie. Okay, right there.
So when it comes to cow-calf handling, any measurements that you can make, you know,
cow-calf ranch?
Like 80% of what you do at home is not.
Oh, cow-calf ranch, for handling, we look at falling, stumbling, electric prod use, vocalization score, and squeeze shoot. It's the same. Well, out on a pasture, I'm going to look at body condition score, lameness, neglected health issues. Now, I'm usually not going to have any swollen hock issues like I would with dairy cattle might get. Body condition, neglected cancerized, something like that, lameness. Well, not so much how they hold their head. The holding their head when I move them, that's so that they don't buck. Okay, let's say the cow bucks at the white line on the highway. They'll do that. If she's looking at that white line, don't try to push her. Wait until her head comes up, and then you push her. Now, if the cattle alert and they put their heads up, you don't want to try to drive them in that position. Well, that's a handling tip. That's not a measurement. The measurement, I can do electric prod use, falling, slipping, for handling, and in evaluating facilities, I can also box score it. Turnbacks, backing ups, stopping. I wouldn't use that for a customer audit, but I'd use that maybe to evaluate something with a handling system. It could either be laid out wrong, or people could be standing in the wrong place. People stand in the wrong place, cattle's going to balk. Now, Ruth Woolley-Wodey did her survey, and I'll try to remember where I put her data. I think it was before this. There it is, right there. Kansas State also did a very similar survey on 56 feed yards, and Kansas came out with the same scores. Now, there's a new Simon study in the Journal of Animal Science on ranches. Yeah, electric prod score average was 25%. Yeah, I need to do a bit better than that. But for a ranch, you can measure these same things on a ranch for assessing handling. Same exact things. You see, the thing I like about measuring handling is like then I can tell, am I getting better or am I getting worse? Now, what you can do, let's say you have 200 head of the measure. I don't have to write the clipboard down for all the animals that where nothing happened. I can just keep track of how many moves I got, how many falls I got, prods I got, and then figure out the percentage from the number of cattle I worked. I can just keep it on a little paper right at the shoot really easily. But that's that right there, that's some scores right there to be proud of. The running is a bit more than what I'd like to see. But the other scores are good. And you can use that same chart. You can look up Ruth's Woolley-Wodey's paper. It's open access. Oh, I've got some papers you might like to look at. I've got a paper called How Do Animals React and Perceive Stressful Situations Such as Handling, Transport, and Slaughter. And I review a lot of the literature on previous experiences. I've got a paper on feedlot welfare, a lot of new papers, 2015, 2016, and then the Ruth Woolley-Wodey. You got to know how to spell Woolley-Wodey. And you got to put R Woolley-Wodey in, or Google doesn't find it, not Ruth. But this is something to be proud of right here. This is something that's a bright spot for the industry. Yeah, the weaned calf thing, that's a bad thing. But this, I can remember the bad old days, your prod score would have been 500%. You know, there's some things where the low-stress handling workshops and all the interest in beef quality assurance stuff is beginning to pay off on this. That's good. And I think I'll end on that, leaving that slide up there, because that's something you can be proud of, those scores. And you can get them off of Roof's papers, open access, available online. Okay, thank you all for coming.